Hey everybody, how's it going? Let's talk about the Kingdom Hearts 3 trailer that we got today at D23. For those who don't know, that's a big expo where they do a bunch of panels on various Disney properties. And of course, during their video game panel, they ended with the best showing. And to be honest, I didn't know, you know, going into it, right? I knew they had a lot of big things like Spider-Man and, you know, Star Wars. And I know that they're much bigger properties, so I'm like, they'll just wedge Kingdom Hearts 3 in the middle. But no, they saved it for last. And I think we know why. It was incredible. We're going to be unpacking this trailer. I'll point out things with my little mouse cursor and pause at various points. This won't be as good as analysis videos you'll get from other big Kingdom Hearts YouTubers. But I'm excited. I want to talk about this. Let's get started. So the trailer opens with Destati in the background with text appearing over screen. It was like, don't let your dreams be dreams, just fucking do it. Whatever Nomura put in there. As I guess that's the philosophy of this game. And right here, we're doing a rail grinding, which as you can see, he's moving a cursor here, a little crosshair, and he can use blaster, so he can shoot out a keyblade blast, similar to a shot lock while grinding. As well as a super slab, which I think could be something like a speed up button similar to that of boosting on rails in that one fight in Kingdom Hearts Dream Drop Distance in the Fantasia world, as well as jumping, which I assume is just jump off. You just jump off. Maybe you have your flow motion power when you're jumping. Who knows? But you have that here. Heartless appear. Sora shoots some of them out. He then targets platforms in this Hercules world with the shot lock. And before, from our last analysis video, learned that there are two types of things in a shot lock you can do. You can choose to unleash, which is to shoot out the attack, or flow chain, which is to teleport to an enemy, or in this case, an object, and do some savvy platforming. A lot of people had theories of whether we could climb the various floating islands in Olympus, whether or not that's going to be a thing. This has basically confirmed it to be a thing. Collecting a bunch of stuff, a lot of verticality in this game is going to be happening. Next up, we have gameplay happening right here in wonderful Twilight Town, here near the mansion fighting Neo Shadows and Dusks, some of the more iconic enemies of the series, and situation commands are still being shown. This is the main way you're doing combat in this game. You are building up combos and doing certain actions which unlock special abilities that you then have a 30-second timer to execute with the triangle button. And you can stack upwards of 5 of these, so you can just unload, whether it's using a bunch of fire giving you Fire Raza, or double arrow guns being available because of some requirements we don't know. It's a really good way to mix up your combat and reward players for doing different shit. But the double arrow guns is something we haven't seen since 2015, which is these bad boys. We got the double dual-wielding, like, handguns the Sora had picked up before, and they have the double arrow guns little logo treatment. I was really sad that this menu here isn't, like, updated dependent on the world. Kingdom Hearts 2 did art assets for every like HUD, every like command menu for all the worlds, and we lost that here. But I guess they wanted to focus more on readability, but they did give a good treatment to the stuff on the top, so I'm cool with that. So he activates the situation command, then he can float around and just shoot a bunch of sparklers out. Now before we, let's roll it back a little bit here. Now he builds up enough to unlock Magic Launcher. And it's standing by to let you know you have it. He hits it, and then it turns the gun into the cannon that we had seen before. Also, these put little stars on his hoodie. That's really neat. Of course, all of these forms and things are drive forms in and of themselves, because they like change Sora's clothes in a way. They've kind of changed how the forms operate. It's all like command style focused. It's less on you doing meter management and more of you just being flexible and using what you have, which people could be hot or cold on. I'm pretty much hot on everything. So now he does the finish command for Magic Launcher, which is basically a tier 2 when you think of it in a command style type of way, where you get the guns, and then you do enough stuff with the guns to unlock the launcher. Then you do a finish command with the launcher, and then you're back to normal. and that stuff's great. We enter Thebes, which is an area in Hercules. This is the city area. And you have some really cool attacks here. We see Sora doing different combos. He's unlocking counter shield quite a bit, Fire Aza. And the only thing of note is that all of the Heartless in this trailer, you see them taking a lot of hits. That's not going to be the same thing in the final game. You'll notice they're like barely losing any health, even though their health bars are low. They have not adjusted that yet. That's the one thing that they're like, this isn't the final game. Then we're going to add the proper attack values versus the defense values of the enemies, and then things will drop, and then HP bars will deplete at a normal rate. This, of course, ends with the fact that they were flashing letters throughout of, don't assume your dreams are just fantasy. If you can imagine a world, believe in it and dive in. This is Nomura fluff. This is where whenever he decides he wants to put some words in, you know, in the game, they tend to be like inspirational, mythical type of things to put in, because that's just the flavor of these games. And we had seen it before in my first reaction video, the E3 trailer. I went, I want to believe in Kingdom Hearts 3. And this seems to just be the philosophy of this game. Don't believe your dreams of this game are just fantasy. If you can imagine a world, believe in it and dive in. So if you can imagine these amazing, fantastic Disney worlds, believe in them and dive in. And to be honest, this is the best Kingdom Hearts trailer I've experienced personally. Because at this moment, as it was about to start, I believed and I told people the one game, the one world I wanted to see. And all we had to do was wait for the letters to break off, and it happened. My belief was manifested in what I call fan fiction. This is all it took. Like, fucking 5 frames is all it took for me to go, this is the best thing ever. Just immediately knowing that this is the Toy Story world that I've been pining for so long. Just, I love the movie, and a world of that in Kingdom Hearts would be great. The fact that we get toy versions of these characters is great. Goofy's got sunglasses on his hat. And they kind of just make him look really pixely. As a way to kind of make the toy thing work. They're making figures out of these, by the way. Like, Bring Arts figures. Which, I believe those retail for like 60 or 70 bucks. They look great. Look at the detail. Like, the mattress has patterns on it from under it. Everything about this just looks so damn good. I've seen people make jokes of this is what you do when you combine Sora with the graphic style of FF7's Lego look. And it looks really good. Again, we're going to let some of this game rock. But I like that they say, why do we look like this? It's to protect the world order, because they have to change forms to match what they're doing. But what I love here is the way they do that. And then the who's that, who's clearly from, I guess, one of the toys over there. This is how the world starts. You like, would you like to enter? The toy's backyard, or whatever they end up calling this place, or Andy's neighborhood, or something. You enter it. This cutscene plays, it transitions the camera to these space-looking Heartless toys, then combat starts. And then you just go in. You just go in against these guys. What's funny is you can tell the health bars are weird because they're already partially damaged. But that's the fun of playing with debugged versions of the game, where you can kind of mess around with aspects of it. We have, looks like these Heartless are using like laser guns, which is pretty cool. These are first new Heartless we've seen in a little bit, and I love them. Again, we're showing off stuff like Blizzard allowing you to slide. And it looks like the Blizzard slide is the redemption or the return of Shock Dive from Dream Drop Distance. So he goes in for the slide here, and then he does a launch, and then he does the attack, and then it's the big slam. But unlike Dream Drop Distance, not as much of a big spectacle in terms of like a big shockwave on the ground with visuals. And it's not given a specific name, which implies to me that flow motion attacks are back, but they're not nearly as boring and just spam them till you win as they were before. And then we have, if I can move it here. He did a couple of attacks coming up. And he has some sort of like upward launcher attack like that. That's really cool. And then it activated Hyper Hammer, which is really, really awesome. If I could pause right here, this is the Toy Story Keyblade. They decided to give it to him because it would work better for people watching the trailer. Get to see what this thing looks like. It is the Buzz Lightyear of Star Command, like hilt, and then a cactus with rope, bandana, Sheriff Star for the teeth, and Woody's hat on it. So it's like the perfect fusion. The perfect fusion of Buzz and Woody. And I love it. This next part is the most absurd thing I've seen since this game was announced. Not the fact that Toy Story's in, that's like the best, but this looks better than the first Toy Story movie. There's always been this thing of like, will games ever look as good as Toy Story did? This does. This looks better, and it looks incredible. Clearly from the plot and the way they're talking and how they're friends, this, since we didn't see Jesse or the horse, I have to assume that this takes place after Toy Story 1, but before Toy Story 2. And, they confirmed it's its own original plot. This is the absurd part. This part fucking kills me. Take this out of context and say, this was a clip from Toy Story 4. And just this right here. And you're like, this is insane! The direction in these scenes are absurd. This is why this game is gonna take 4 to 5 years to be completed. This looks amazing. My expectations were smashed. And it's like, okay, Organization 13 is gathering to various worlds and just causing trouble. So they have more of an effect on the Disney stuff. It's really just so good, man. But this is why I love this scene so much, because it's a full cutscene. He's like, you know, that dude has something to do with our friends vanishing. He's our problem, too. And I'm like, this is so cool. I would pay... If they gave you a version of this game that would give you, like, Tom Hanks and Tim Allen and, like, the original Disney cast for these games, and you'd have to pay double the price of the game, I'd pay triple. Because that just... Ugh. Then the fact of hearing Tom Hanks or Tim Allen saying Keyblade or Xehanort would be amazing. But this right here, this is what I've wanted for over a decade. Ever since I was a little kid, beat Kingdom Hearts 1, I wanted a Toy Story world. And this is just so... This visual is perfect. It's just like, this is what people want when they think about Kingdom Hearts, when they think about going on an adventure with this main character and Donald and Goofy. Going along with Disney characters, it's shots like this. Look at little Rex's little feety. Look at his little feet just going like when he gets really hype. He's like, eee! It's so good. People are putting up image comparisons between Rex and Ham in this trailer compared to the movie, and they look better. And then they're like, this is the way to prove to you this is a completely new story within the Toy Story universe. Is, our friends are gone, and then we gotta go to Galaxy Toys. And then you get to see the various things that you may see there as, like, a hint. Like, these robots, they're the new Gigas. The Gigas robots. And that means, we see them later in the trailer, so maybe we'll see more of this. Maybe we'll see these, like, Barbie-looking dolls. Maybe you do some combos where you can jump on these cars and, like, grind... Like, they're riding and you jump on them and you do combos and stuff. Who knows? And then when they say this is up... And then we're outside. And then I'm just like, this is the best! We have the upgraded versions of these Mook Heartless that are just of an element. Where we have fire. I don't know what this is. It's kind of like a pinkish. So I don't think it's Blizzard. It might be its own different type. So that's good. Another upgrade... We can see right here, two party members. Oh, wait, no, five people. This is great because it means that you get to have Woody and Buzz. You don't get to compromise. Be like, but I need Donald's healing. Or, I want Goofy because I want, like, a cool limit move he has or a link move that he has. No, fuck that shit. We're gonna get everybody. No compromises. This also means, potentially, if they want to push the plot with her, you could have an endgame where it's your party is Sora, Donald, Goofy, Riku, and Kairi, and that might make me lose my fucking shit. So, regular combos here. Bunch of different aerial types, though, which gets me very excited. Combo variation is something that was definitely needed in Birth by Sleep and Dream Drop Distance, and we haven't seen much in that variety from Osaka team since they took over development. That's exciting. Hyper Hammer appears, which is the transformation for this world. We see this again. It is now confirmed anytime Sora jumps, it looks like, he goes into this phase and can do a diving strike. Let's see if there's anything in the command bar that changes. Like, we know diving strike's there, but is there a button that he has to press to enter this specific animation? Alright. He falls. And no, it just does a natural transition to it. You can see the great, like, how well they modeled the toy-ness of it. This dude's like, aw, fuck. These guys are like, I don't know what's going on. And then, slamming in. And he has Hyper Hammer activated. He uses it. And then the Keyblade then transforms into this hammer with the big old Sheriff Star on it. And I'm assuming that they've modeled these and not restricted them to each Keyblade. It could be an idea of these things being limited to what Keyblade you're using, but we'll have to see. And he can do a bunch of different hammer-style combos with it. And he gets Blazaga as an example here. And then Drill Punch becomes activated once using it enough. And it is, of course, a Tier 2. There's the finish command for that hammer, or at least something that looks something to that effect. Then he activates the drill, which is so fucking awesome. Now, I really want to highlight how this is some of the best animation the game has shown us. He goes in for the drill, right? He goes in, and then you see Sora just that perfect toy look. But it's right here when he spins it, and it plays the perfect sound. Just, I love that. Because then you remember he is a toy, and then this is the super large world. The grass quality is great. Not going to look great in your video, but it looks better if you definitely check out the full trailer on the Kingdom Hearts YouTube channel, youtube.com/KingdomHearts. It's cool that they got that link, by the way. Or if you go search the press site for Square Enix, like Square Enix press site, you can actually download the source video. Probably tomorrow, because today, fans like me have crashed that site. Can't get anything on there right now. So, he does combos. He looks like he has various things like being able to drill into the ground and then come out from the ground to do an attack. And then eventually we'll see the finish move, which you can tell none of the ones we've seen before are finishes, because they would have shown it. The finish move for this guy is this right here, where he then turns the drill into a claw with a laser rope. And then just starts picking up whatever enemy and slamming them. Animation quality. This is something that, while Final Fantasy XV has a lot of faults, that game had some very good animations, especially with how your character reacts and in the AI character animations. This is beating that. It's so absurd. Holy shit. So, at this point, this shot is amazing. We got the whole crew going in at this Galaxy Toys section, of course, using the new reorchestrated version of Wave of Darkness. And then we learned that through a situation command, I guess, or just doing a certain thing, you can take over these robot toys, the Gigas that they are called. I've seen some people say that some of the symbols on them imply that maybe they look like a new enemy type. I don't believe that. I think they're just toys that are being possessed by the Heartless, and thus you can possess them yourself. This menu, fucking awesome. This is the thing that you would see in all the other Kingdom Hearts games like KH2 and stuff. Whenever something was different and they changed the HUD, you got your HP meter like this. You got the cool little extra trimmings. Tackle, blaster, punch, booster, danger dash, eject. So you can then also eject on the fly as well. Now, as soon as you get out, you seem to be able to do like that, looked like a slight air dash, kinda? Again, I'm really bad at pulling it back here. Let's, he goes for the tackle there. And then he gets this big, like, visual key of, like, I'm dashing forward. So it looks like the air dashes are back in. And yeah, you can ride just by hitting triangle button. There's a prompt there. This one has Exploder, Blaster, Punch, Booster, Danger Dash. So each one has a special move it can do. And Exploder, I assume, will be that large set of blasts that you saw before, which look really good. And of course, you have to defeat some of these because they are possessed by the enemy. Some people thought that maybe the chest part there would be Unverse related. I was seeing people say that, like right here. I don't think so. I just think it's enemies being possessed. I don't expect another new enemy type to be born in this game. I wouldn't complain necessarily, but I think a good balance of new Heartless and new Nobodies will take this. Especially more Heartless, because Heartless are the bread and butter. So, we continue to get amazing gameplay. This very big, large, you know, main room for the toy store. And we're blasting some dudes. Showing off how each one has each of these robots have their own special move, and when you use them, they then go on this cooldown. This cooldown that kind of has, like, this wavy bar effect. And then we have some dialogue here, see if we can unpack it. One heart's shadows fill the emptiness of another. See how they bring them to life? Like Heartless and Nobodies, they fit together. So, I'm trying to think of how this fits in this world. So, one heart's shadows fill the emptiness of another. So are they trying to say how if they can bring toys to life? Is that kind of how he's going like that? Like Heartless and Nobodies, they fit together. So darkness with the toys? And he's like, there is a darkness we are missing and must reclaim. The way hearts connect in this world may provide a clue. So the organization have entered the Toy Story world. Because they don't have a 13th darkness yet. They basically proclaim that because their plans had failed in Dream Drop Distance to get Sora. Who is the darkness they have in mind? It probably isn't going to be Sora because he's the main character. So they're looking for different ways to do it. And they're trying to integrate the organization within the world. And we already know they make like a dark version of Baymax in the Big Hero 6 world. And they probably have something going on in Hercules, and we haven't seen anything at Tangled. So, it's looking like that Kingdom Hearts 3, which, let's get that really good new logo drop that they made from last trailer. What this game is attempting to do is something that I'm so glad. This is no longer Disney movie The Abridged series. This is, we're gonna take this Disney movie, and we're gonna say, what if they had a direct-to-video sequel? And we're gonna make it up as we go along. The writing has now become less lazy. It's less focused on, hey, let's retell Aladdin, Return of Jafar. It's more, what if Aladdin went on this journey and did this? Aladdin isn't in Kingdom Hearts 3 as far as we know, but you know what I mean. They're taking a movie like Hercules, developing a new story, taking a story like Toy Story, making a new story out of it. And that is refreshing. It's going to make the game even more approachable, you know? And it makes it worth experiencing. And again, I love this logo quite a bit. Light, darkness, darkness, light, dark, light. It's just, everything about this is still really strong, but I'm glad that they switched it. Originally, it was like three sparkles shooting down as the three Roman numerals. But now they're like coming in and then they're revealing it. Because that was the 2013 look. This is the 2017 look. And the final look, as far as I'm concerned. And of course, this always kind of looked pretty cool. They always do a good job of making the Kingdom Hearts words look varied in KH 1, 2, and 3, respectively. And then this. So, when it was like this, when it was all the consoles, which, LOL. they're doing it out of obligation at this point. I'm not console hating, I'm just saying 2013 was a different time when we didn't know who was gonna, you know, who was gonna sell and who wasn't. But when it was just a black screen here, my heart knew. My heart fucking knew, guys. I think we all knew. Why would it be all black we needed to see the now in development slash the 2019 slash the coming soon. But they know. Nomura knows. Osaka team knows. Square Enix knows. They kept doing now in development because it was still in development. But Square Enix, and this is true for all their games, they don't give you a window unless they plan to hit it. And then I get chills. 2018. So let's talk about that a little bit. I was right. I think everyone was right. A lot of people were saying, hey, 2018, because the game started development in 2013. They lost a little progress, about a year's worth, switching from the Luminous engine, which is what Final Fantasy XV runs on, and instead did Unreal Engine 4, which looks fantastic, as you've seen. And I guess I'll play some B-roll here just to get it going. So we had this entire... Since development started, it's been 4 years. And my idea was that that in 2018, that meant they were working on the game and trying to get the game out over 5 years. 5 years is a good amount of time. A lot of times people feel like that's longer than the average game, but sometimes that's not even true. A lot of games work on stuff in a half-finished state from the beginning. Like, say, an Assassin's Creed game, for example, they usually have a template or they have a lot of stuff built from the ground up because they continue to make those and iterate on what they have. With Kingdom Hearts 3, they couldn't really do that. All the assets that already existed from the game, their highest quality ones were probably stuff from maybe Dream Drop Distance, Birth by Sleep, or Kingdom Hearts 2. Then they had to make something from not the 360 era, but from the PS4 era, this current generation of consoles, but they also want to push that technology and make the best looking thing that they can, and they're doing that here. They're making something visually amazing, and making all those assets and the systems from the ground up, and expecting them, one, to learn an engine, which they then gave up on, and then learn Unreal Engine 4 from the ground up, a engine that none of the people on that staff had known how to use, is quite the undertaking. And then you have to think about, this was being worked on while they were working on Kingdom Hearts 2.5, Kingdom Hearts 2.8, and then porting 1.5 and 2.5 to the current generation of consoles, as well as 2.8 having a Kingdom Hearts 3 2 to 2.5 hours of gameplay. So then you have all of that work being done while this is being done, and then it starts to make sense of 5 years to create Kingdom Hearts 3 is a perfectly acceptable amount of time, and the quality speaks for itself. It looks incredible. And a lot of people are saying, well, Persona 5 had a winter 2014, never forget. And I'm like, well, first of all, I made a joke about it where I was actually extremely blunt. Said, well, Atlas is incompetent. People took offense. By that, I mean Creed. But it's just, like, what I'm saying is, like, Square doesn't do that. Square doesn't say it's coming out at the end of this trailer with this date, and then they don't hit anything close to it. They'll do now in development. Like, some people would like to say is like, well, Versus 13 didn't come out. I'm like, yeah, but they never give us a fucking date. I never went and watched a Versus 13 trailer and saw the thing of saying, look forward to playing this in October of 2011. Like, no, we never got that. There's been one time in recent memory that I can remember that because of development woes, a game had a date and it was pushed. And that was Final Fantasy 15. And to be quite honest, that was only pushed by about 3 months. Square isn't, once they handle a date, they're going to push a game out. Because they're not going to spend half a decade working on a game anymore, or anything beyond that, let alone, and not bring it out to people. They don't plan on doing that anymore, you know? They want to make money. They want to make money. And they've changed CEOs since the days that Versus 13 was even announced, so that's why the game eventually went out as is. And even if this game gets pushed out as is, I think it's going to be damn good. A lot of people are like, oh man, but what if it was unfinished? I don't have any reservations about this being unfinished. Look at what they have here. They've basically shown us that a Toy Story World has completely made cutscenes, gameplay, it's all coming together. What we're watching through two trailers at the orchestra last month and at D23 this month is the beginning of Kingdom Hearts 3 being pushed regularly. What I'm saying is it's not out of the realm of possibility for you to see another trailer of this game and even expect it at Tokyo Game Show, to expect one at Jump Festa in December. It's not out of the realm of possibility to make sure that you're going to be seeing this game every 2 to 3 months until it's out. And when it's about to come out, seeing new trailers and hype for it once a week. Just the same way that Final Fantasy XV toward its launch was getting a major media push. It's happening. And of course, they gave themselves the best out. They said 2018, which means that they're confident that it's going to launch at some point then. Which, in the end, 15 came out in November, so they have no problems pushing something as far as December. Also, to address something that I said earlier about the only game I could remember Square did where they announced a date and it got delayed was 15. That's wrong, technically, because Kingdom Hearts 2.8 was delayed. But don't worry, Nomura openly admitted in a public statement that certain other major projects of the company made them have to readjust 2.8's date. Basically saying the delay of 15 delayed 2.8, which basically says that Osaka Team, the team that has been making Kingdom Hearts games for almost a decade now since RE Chain of Memories, has continued to deliver their games on time and have, you know, hit their expectations. But this is their big break. This is their big chance to give us the biggest game yet, and this is it. Again, expect better breakdowns and analysis videos from the major Kingdom Hearts YouTubers that I seem that you can look up. I'm sure if you look up an orchestra trailer analysis video, you'll be able to find some better ones, and then those people will put out some good deep cuts when they do. But what I can say here is that Kingdom Hearts 3 is real. Kingdom Hearts 3 is coming out. Just think that within a year, I might have already beaten it. Because we don't know when it's happening. I don't think it's early, because they would say it was early regardless. My prediction is that it's coming out September. I'm going to predict September, the game will be coming out, and it'll be a very exciting time. The hope is that it is a full worldwide release with no break in between days. I know at one point he said that it might come out on a few days early in Japan. I hope not, because I don't have to buy it twice, because I will do that. And in the end, I'd like to thank you guys so much for watching. This is one of the best days I've had in months, this trailer. This trailer was better than the last one because it helped realize a dream I've had for more than half my life for a piece of media I like. I wanted a Toy Story world in Kingdom Hearts. I've wanted it since I was 11 years old. And we got it. So with that, thank you guys for watching, and look forward to more content on the channel, my Let's Plays, and my Kingdom Hearts full series retrospective Let's Play, because that's still going, and see you guys later.